Breaking news coming in from Bet365, where every nail-biting overtime win, breakaway, pick six, three-point shot, underdog win, buzzer beater, shootout, walk-off, and absolutely every play in between is amazing. From football to basketball and hockey to baseball, whatever the moment, it's never ordinary at Bet365. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. 21 plus only. Must be physically located in Virginia.
Well, well, well. Look who's back. The Utah Blockcast. Me, Brian, and Cam. They just had to do it to us. They had to do it to us. The elephant in the room, guys. Utah Jazz uniforms.
God, they're so bad. It's so, so bad. We're watching the... As we're sitting here recording in Block Cave 2.0.
Dr. Bartle's office?
Yes.
Yes.
The new office. Yeah,
Dr. Bartle's office.
I have been diagnosed. It is terminal. I have been diagnosed with terrible Jazz uniforms.
They are horrible.
It's the font. The font does
nothing
for me.
No, it is not the font. It is all of it. It's all of it.
Horrible.
It is the font. It is the yellow. It is the white somehow. It is the arrangement of all of those things. And I was telling Steve before we recorded, I was like, it's like they took a knob of like, oh, how much detail should we add? And they turned it to zero, and it was just nothing. And they were like, that's not enough. And then they turned it to one, and they were like, perfect.
Perfect.
Send it.
Now is a good point to point out that this is the summer of Cam. And like your dress code has... Dress code
evolved.
Style?
Yeah. Yes.
Like you Pitbull are... should be on the lookout because you are coming for his game.
I'll tell you what. Nobody asked me about the Jazz uniforms.
Damn right they didn't.
You got to let them know. This is why we're recording.
There would have been a little bit more peach in it. Utah fans would have been like, this is a... It would have been a,
this
it would
is
been
unexpected.
A vibe, but it would have been out of nowhere.
More pastels?
Good.
More pastels. Always.
All pastels.
Always more
yeah.
pastels.
Like very landscapey. Some
you know,
sky
we're,
blue.
We're like, what's the season that the NBA doesn't play? The summer? We're like, let's go all summer tones. Yeah.
That's a very
I feel like,
Utah sunset color. The peach that you got on. We
yeah.
see that often.
So just to recap for everybody.
Visual
who,
podcast.
Yeah. As a visual medium here.
Very much is.
We actually could make it visual in this
we could.
Room. Yeah.
We have before.
It's been done.
Oh, not in this
we
room.
We have the technology.
We have the technology.
Cam is wearing... They're blue, but not like...
Some Jordan 1 retros.
Yeah.
Some peach color Nike fleece tech sweats. Mm. And a dope throwback Florida Gator t-shirt.
Home field
t-shirt. Shout out to Home Field.
Home Field does not sponsor us yet, but they get the shout out anyways.
Well, because... We got to Blockcast more yeah. in order to do that. But anyways, guys... Utah Jazz uniforms are horrible and podcast.
That's
I'm just
all,
kidding.
Yeah, no, that's all I. That was
and
all
Cam,
we needed
Cam
to
got style.
That was the news for the day.
How many Blockcast members are currently wearing a chain?
Probably one, two. Two?
I got my.
You got yours on?
Pirate chain.
Cam,
on.
You got yours on?
Oh, yeah.
I got to get a Blockcast chain.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that's on me. That's on me. That'll be for the next episode.
I got a guy.
Yeah, you got a guy. You know a guy.
We're Blockcast to Blockchain.
All right. Well, now that we got the elephant in the room addressed,
and
we can talk
sharply.
On, we can hit on some other subjects that probably need to be talked about.
Levathion the elephant is dressed lights out.
All right, guys.
Head to toe.
So USC, UCLA to the Big Ten. Leaves the
Wait,
Pac-12.
What?
Oh yeah, sorry, can't. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh. Okay. No, I remember now. I think I remember seeing something about that.
This is essentially the like USC and UCLA just buried the Pac-12 in Lake Powell.
Yep.
We discovered the body last week on Wednesday because the lake is disappearing.
Disappearing, just like the Pac-12.
So. Do we want to go through timeline of events? Because I think that's something, and we actually have a show plan. So,
we
like,
do.
The upgraded Block Cave is already producing massive results.
Yeah, huge.
And I think it's important to as we transition to talk about kind of the timeline of events, because I think a lot of people think that this has been in play for months.
Yeah.
Right? And the reality is, as I've kind of gathered some information, I was listening to Bruce Feldman today on Ryan Russillo's podcast. Like, it's really just like the last 2 or 3 weeks that everything started going full speed with USC and UCLA into the Big
right.
Ten.
Right. Yeah. No, there has been conversations in the past. I think first contact between USC and Kevin Warren was actually, I think it was actually last year, but they were put off.
Yeah,
and then they reignited in March, I think is when USC reached back out to the Big Ten. Mm-hmm. And then over the last few weeks, this has really kind of picked up.
This is just like what we saw last year with Texas and Oklahoma, though, in the sense that when it was first announced, if we all recall, we thought it was a joke.
Yeah.
And we thought it was Texas overplaying their hand of the Big 12 needs us more than we need them, and this is our opportunity to show it. And then
like a Houston beat reporter, like somebody that we've never that broke the news? Am I remembering that
right? I
think
it was a Chronicle reporter. I think you're right on that.
A Houston where it was just like, and that kind of added to the mystery or the.
Yeah, and more to say that when these things do happen, they're obviously well orchestrated and well planned, but they move quickly, and that's on purpose, right?
Yeah.
It's USC is not trying to make things easier for the Pac-12 schools that they're leaving behind. That's simply not their goal, and these things move quickly so that they happen and things don't get put off and things get ugly when they don't happen quickly. My point is simply that we're going to continue to probably see things not happen and then happen quickly. You know, this is the type of thing that once this type of news starts to come out, it's usually already done. We will hear about it when the ink is already drying.
It's like one of those YouTube videos where you see the guy hit the domino and it hits just a couple dominoes and then all of a sudden it zooms out and it's just this massive mosaic of 5 million dominoes and they're all falling at once and it turns into this picture, whether you like it or not. Oh, they just show the Jazz uniforms again. They look
just awful.
Just awful.
Terrible on TV.
Stupid.
With that court, no go.
Yeah, it's horrible.
It's so bad.
With the court, it's awful.
Even without the court, I'm just looking at these uniforms, and I'm really glad we got to spend more time on this.
Yeah.
Because as I'm sitting here looking at the Jazz uniforms, too, so I'm looking at the logo, like the score logo, right?
Yeah.
And it looks at, like when I'm looking at the brand from that perspective, I'm like, if this is what Ryan Smith was going for, like, what is the logo and the contrast and the logo image we could create like on a website, you know, like his specialty, what he does,
right.
Like an app avatar.
It looks great.
Yeah.
Like this yellow and the black, it's a great contrast. The black really pops on and really feels like it's jumping off the yellow. And, it's like he didn't know that it was for an NBA team that would then have to have uniforms and a court.
So weird.
It's like they designed the team from the website out.
Yeah.
And and I don't know if I've ever been to the Utah Jazz website.
Yeah.
So
I have.
Do you think do you think the Jazz uniforms was a process where it came together quickly like the USC to Big Ten thing?
I was going
to
say.
Or was this like a slow process where Nike was like, are you sure about these?
So,
you want to talk to your team? Like, do you need more approval, Ryan? Like, where do we think this was? Was this something where it was, like, drawn out and Nike was just like, look, man, are you sure? Or was it just something that came together quickly?
I feel like this was the other way around. I feel like Nike had a lot of influence on this because that is very much an Oregon Duck-looking number where it is too big for the jersey.
Hmm.
And that is very much a Oregon Duck highlighter yellow.
Mm-hmm.
So I wonder if maybe it's like Nike's like, hey, check out what we did. And Ryan Smith just got real distracted because this has happened to me. You get too many emails in a day and you're like, oh, shoot, I forgot to respond to that Nike. And you're like, hey, it looks good. And then all of a sudden you have this and you totally screwed up your brand.
Anyways, we got distracted by ESPN. We got ESPN on.
I think part of this interlude goes back to what we were going to talk about, which is our panic level right now. And the fact that we're so easily flowing in and out of how bad the Jazz uniforms are. Maybe does that make you feel like is that indicative of your panic level, Steve? Let me ask you that.
My panic level?
Wait, about the Jazz uniforms still, right? That's what we're panicking about? I just want to make sure. I just want to
fix them for two more years.
I want to make sure that our
listeners panic mode.
That when we talk about we're on critical panic mode, all hands on deck panic mode. That is in reference to the Jazz uniforms.
To the Jazz uniforms. Yes, that's where I'm at. When it comes to the Pac-12, to me. It's interesting.
That's when you know something big's coming.
Are we panicking about the Pac-12 or about Utah?
About Utah. Yes, about Utah.
Different panic levels for those.
Sorry. Yes.
My panic level is
Pac-12 panic level is
Lake Powell
through the roof.
Lake Powell low.
They are dying to get some Ryan Smith uniforms.
Everyone at the Pac-12 offices, which do not exist anymore,
they're all at home.
Everyone at home should be. Running around, they should be running around yelling and being less productive. That's how panicked I think they should be.
Yeah.
I hope everybody in the Pac-12 that works at the Pac-12 ate an oatmeal cream pie today to calm down, as we did right before the show started.
I think that's just fuel for the fire. I hope
fuel
anyways.
For the panic.
But with panic in regard to Utah, it's interesting to me. I think for a lot of people and. I've been reading a lot of posts at UteZone, and I think panic level all revolves around your beliefs and how you view the Big 12. I think for a lot of people, view the Big 12 as DEFCON 5, level 5 panic because the potential for Utah to end up there.
I'm glad you mentioned that, and I'm glad you brought it up because I'm sure that somebody out there is going to tell us that it's DEFCON 1.
I was
going to
say,
DEFCON 1.
And
DEFCON
5.
It's up there.
DEFCON 5 is
peace. Sorry. Okay, DEFCON 1.
It makes more sense to have DEFCON be 5 because that's the highest number.
You crank it up, you don't crank it down.
Yeah. It's like AC.
Yeah.
I do kind of want to dip into that a little bit because I think there's multiple factors involved with that, right? I think the biggest one for Utah fans specifically is, oh crap, we're back in a conference with BYU.
I think that's it.
Because for the last 10-ish years, we've talked a lot of trash online and on Cougar Board and everywhere possible to our neighbors. We're coming off a Rose Bowl appearance, a Pac-12 championship. Everything should be great. And now we're back with... We moved out into our own room, got it decorated, looking dope. Dad lost his job.
Yeah, I think it's...
Mom left, dad lost the job, and now we're moving back in with brother.
The BYU thing, if that is why people are hung up, I think that's silly, personally. I think there's plenty of reasons to not want to go to the Big 12 that aren't BYU.
I don't know, though. I think it's, I think there's... Reasons to, I don't know. I think there are reasons to not want
that. Here's my puzzling part about it is I want to know why it was that the Big 12 suddenly became the icon in this whole battle, right? Why was the Big 12 suddenly the conference that everybody should want to move into? Even though USC and UCLA pulled the classic. So this is my metaphor for it, right? All 12 of us in the Pac-12 here started our own little startup. We've been battling through it, got funded, had some mistakes. Finally got rid of the crappy CEO that didn't know what they were doing. They're just robbing us. And finally got somebody in there that actually has some semblance of ability. And then all of a sudden, UCLA and USC come to the table and be like, yeah, I wrecked my dad's Lamborghini, so now I got to go get a real job. And now that they're bouncing and there's just 10 of us left.
Yeah.
But why do we all have to bail on this startup when there's still something there? There's still viable product for a McDonald's franchise, in essence.
I've lost this metaphor.
We are all over the place with that metaphor.
Yeah, I didn't think through that part of it. So I don't know what the Big 12 represents. But what I'm saying is that all of a sudden the Big 12 became this icon. Is like, oh, you should want to go to the Big 12 now.
Yeah.
What's the matter with just saying in the Pac-10?
Yeah. I think that's...
Yeah, for me, it comes down to Oregon and Washington, right?
Yeah.
If I think the biggest framing of the Big 12 is if Oregon and Washington leave the Pac-12, then the Big 12 is kind of the only regionally realistic option for Utah that is still kind of that still resembles a power conference, or at least, you know, what was previously a power conference. But I think that. Yeah, I think that the problem is, without knowing what Oregon and Washington are going to do, there's to me no team. Oklahoma State maybe with Oregon, right? I would kind of maybe I'm trying to think on like a brand or value perspective or just viewership perspective, and I don't know the numbers, so don't yell at me if I'm wrong. But
a team from the Big 12?
No, but I mean, just like there's no team to me in the Big 12 that I would rather play on a yearly basis or, you know, 2 out of 3 years or something than Oregon, or than certainly not USC, right? Like to me, once Texas and Oklahoma left that conference, no one in that conference was as valuable or as meaningful as a traveling partner or like as another team in your conference as USC was. And so now they're gone. And so to me, moving to the Big 12 is perhaps a lateral move, but it's from one sinking ship to a ship that has less holes and for now appears to be afloat.
I would say that this ship is just lodged on a different island. That you're still out in the middle of the ocean, not really being at shore.
Yeah, but if that island has resources, I'd rather be on that island.
Which is fine. Like, I think the problem here is that the big issue is Utah fans and a lot of fans in college football still think this is about winning a national championship, right? Like, that's always the goal. And I think Utah fans are starting to really buy in, like, with a Rose Bowl appearance now, like, hey, we might even be able to make the college football playoff and someday win a national championship. Like, that's always the goal. Problem is that you're going up against literally hundreds of millions of dollars across the sport, but also just – this has been a huge next step. From this level up to that next level is the most impossible step, right? You're right there on the cusp of it, but it's the hardest move to make. Like, we look at what Clemson struggled with, and Clemson's going to Clemson for, what, a decade, almost mm-hmm. two? Mm-hmm. And that was a program that had all the resources, had the money, had the donors, had the facilities. And it took them forever to get to the point to where they took that next step.
I think that's, Brian, I think, you know, that's an interesting talk. Because I think that is an underlying frustration with this whole thing, because it feels like Utah broke through last year, obviously with the Pac-12 championship, their performance in the Rose Bowl, and it felt like they were right there, ready to take that next step. And all of a sudden, you know, the stool got knocked from under them, and with USC and UCLA bouncing. And now it's like, what's the next move? Where do we build from here? How do we build from here? There's unsurety and a lot of worry about how Utah continues on this upward trend that they've been on over the last few years. I think that's kind of something that isn't being talked about as much, but I think is a deeper concern for a lot of people. It's something that, as you were talking about Clemson and making that climb, that all connected for me. And I think it's frustrating for sure. And, you know, so from that perspective, it's frustrating. But the thing to keep in mind here is you still have two more seasons of Pac-12 football. What happens over the next 30 days with George Kliavkoff and this media negotiation window that has now been opened for him with ESPN and Fox? What can he do? And what comes of that will be really, really interesting to see. So, you know, getting back to panic level, you know, I mentioned that I think a lot of people, in terms of how they view the Big 12, Brian, you made the good point of, as well as how you view being in a conference with BYU kind of impacts your panic. I think still Utah has done enough over the last decade and over the last 5 years more specifically to climb that hierarchy of college football, yeah, college athletics in general, to where you know, we talked about it before the show. You can feel comfortable. You can feel confident that Utah will have a place in the future of college football and whatever it's going to look like with these super leagues.
And we were in a group chat today where we talked about this a little bit. And my point is this. I think as a Utah fan, if you're gauging your panic level should be low right now.
Yeah.
Because the chips are going to fall where they fall no matter what. But you still have 2 years worth of movement and possibilities coming until those media right negotiations are locked in for sure.
Yep.
And that's the nice thing about this is while they do need to finalize it at some point, there is going to be this is not going to be like we got a 2 year window. So unless like Texas and Oklahoma jump immediately or something weird like that happens to really facilitate. And I think Cam made that point earlier that like if you're in this game, like you got to make a move.
Yeah.
Right. And you want it to go fast, especially I think if, you know, USC and UCLA right now giving 2 years window, I think that's a really bad move on their part.
You can't afford to drag your feet on something like this because unless you're a school like Notre Dame, who teams will wait around for, who conferences will wait around for, and someone will take your place. Even, you know, if you're USC and, you know, if you're dragging your feet too hard, you know, someone will take your place eventually.
Or if you're – sorry, go ahead. If you're counting on your spot being there and not doing anything to secure it, that's a problem too. And I think what I want to connect all this to is that Utah is in a great place in terms of what's going to happen in the 2022 season, because you have a team that's returning with a ton of starters, a very young but very talented defense. You have one of the top 10 quarterbacks in the country, maybe even top five.
Yeah.
And we talked about this back in February, March, said like, just wait until Cam Rising gets into some of the camps and gets around some of the other quarterbacks, you're going to start hearing his name a lot more on draft boards.
Yeah.
Lo and behold, he goes to the Manning camp, and suddenly everybody's like, wow, you know, that Cam Rising is quite a quarterback.
He's cool,
and,
calm, and, collected.
Yeah.
You know, he's thick.
He must eat a lot of chicken sandwiches. But that's where I think the panic level can drop if you're a Utah fan, because if this team hits its expectations, which mine are high, you know, and we can talk about that down the road as we get closer to the actual season. My expectation is that if this team really is as good as we think and or hope it is, if it really does hit their ceiling, they're a college football playoff team.
Yeah.
And maybe even they win a game somehow. Yeah. And if that happens and you get into a national championship game, and this is the most unlikely scenario, but this is the Doctor Strange lifting up the one finger scenario. If that all happens, now all of a sudden you're the absolute darling of college football, and the Big Ten and the SEC are like, you're not going to play. What a riot you would cause, because everybody's gonna be like, you're not going to take home Cinderella. You know, even today when I was listening to Russillo's podcast, he had a great rant about, I effing hate what's happening. And then he went through and broke it down for all these teams about, you know, how has realignment worked for Nebraska? How has it worked for Missouri? How has it really worked out for Texas A&M? Like, I know they've got gobs of money, but really Texas A&M has been irrelevant until NIL hit.
Yeah.
You know? So it really hasn't worked out for any of these. Nebraska? They're way worse off. Woosa. I gotta calm down. But that's my point, is that if you do this, if you run the table like we think and feel like Utah can, and it all goes down, and Utah's on the outside looking in, it is an absolute disaster for the Big Ten, the SEC, and the powers that be at college football, because it's just going to disrupt everything.
Yeah, I think, so again, I think we're all in agreement, Pac-12, panic level, through the roof, whatever, trying to figure out.
Whatever DEFCON is highest.
Yeah.
Is it 3.14?
Is it 1? Is it 5? What is it?
Pi.
But I think for Utah, I mean, yes, there's some panic, right? You're unsure of your future now. You've got 2 years of Pac-12 football left. You got to figure out where you're going to be, where you fit in. Brian, you made a great point that Utah has a great opportunity this season to, again, improve their resume and take that next step. And I think that that's something to keep in mind, is, you know, nothing changes this season and nothing changes next season. So we'll see. But, man. So for you guys, like, switching it up, like, what seems most likely? What's going to come of all of this? Like, does Utah ultimately get an invite to one of these two eventual super conferences, or are we looking at a Big 12 invite? Do we see a Pac-12 merger of some sort, like Pac-10, I guess? Like, what do we see as most likely to come over the next few years? Maybe months, maybe weeks.
Yeah, it's hard to say what's most likely, obviously, and for all the reasons we were saying earlier, that this is going, it'll be cagey until the ink is drying, and that's when we'll find out. I think right now, today, to me, it feels most likely still that that there's some sort of merger of teams or movement of teams between the Pac-12 and the Big 12. Now, whether that will go in one direction or the other, to be determined. We've seen the most about teams joining the Big 12, but we are hearing to at the end of today, the end of Tuesday, about you know, George Kliavkov doing, you know, work or whatever, and making some moves,
kicking ass.
Kicking ASS so hard that Zombie Alliance is in discussions of Alliance 2.0, the alliancing.
The Alliance is missing a leg or two, but that's okay. It's still alive and breathing.
Barely. Yeah, we're going to run that back because the first time one of the members stole the biggest teams from the other members, and so we're going to see if we can't... we can't learn that mistake again.
You don't succeed, try again, baby.
But I want to talk a little bit. But
I do just want to say, like, I think the most likely scenario we see is those two teams passing those two conferences passing some teams around, because it really just doesn't make a lot of sense for like regionally for other teams to get involved. There aren't a lot of other like teams that make sense to pull into these conferences on the West Coast. It's just not dense with football schools to bring in. And frankly, the one that I think makes the most sense to me is just too hard to do regionally, which would be something, the big conference that isn't being talked about right now because of its kind of regional isolation between the scraps that remain right now is the ACC. And the Pac-12 working something out with the ACC would be great, but, I mean, everything we know about travel and, you know, college football and, you know, regionality, it gets thrown out the window with that because you're going to be having six-hour flights for away games.
So this is a good chance to kind of talk about the dissemination of information, right? Because as we came into Tuesday, everybody thought that there was going to be a big meeting with the Pac-12 and four Pac-12 teams, or the Big 12 and four Pac-12 teams, right? And now as we're recording, we're starting to hear reports about, well, maybe the Pac-12 and the ACC are going to create an alliance, and maybe they'll have a championship game in Las Vegas, and maybe that will leverage ESPN into more money. And then there's also the conversation about Oklahoma State possibly leaving. So all this stuff is starting to trickle out on Twitter. And the reason is that it's trickling out now is because that's the day's conversations, right? So all the stuff that was supposedly talked about on Friday and into the weekend has now transitioned to this. And so now we're starting to really find out what the real story was, right? I never really bought that report from Jason Shear. I was like, wait a second. I know this guy. Why is he the one that's breaking this story?
Yeah.
And I'm not saying his sources are bad.
What report specifically?
Like the one about the four...
Just the four schools meeting with the Big 12. I bought it.
Yeah.
Bought into it.
Well, I'm not knocking his sources. My question with that stuff is always just like, okay, why is it that he's the one that's got this?
Sure.
Right? You know what I mean? And so I always kind of try and walk through it in my mind, like, what's the point of this? What's the point of that? You know, sometimes when you see like teams in the NBA make a weird free agent signing, you're like, why did they do that? The first thing I go is check and see who the agent is and see what free agent that they really want to have that they're pursuing. And so you figure out, oh, it's a favor, right? Mm. So I kind of wondered about that, but I think really what it boils down to is if you're looking at what's most likely, I think initially the Big Ten, everybody wanted to be in there. And the thought was like, if Oregon and Washington leave, that's when we're screwed. And there were initial reports that like Oregon and Washington would be interested. The Big Ten network is majority owned by Fox. Okay. 51%. So because of that, when the Big Ten opened up their negotiation window for their rights deal, there were literal Fox executives in on these meetings as other networks came in to present. So they knew exactly what they were going up against. They knew what everybody else's information was. They knew everything ahead of time. And so they were able to just kind of basically pick and choose from whatever was across the country what they wanted. And this is per Stuart Mandel. This is where I got all this information from. So you don't think I'm just pulling stuff outside of my head, because I've had a few missed metaphors tonight. I'm not on my A game. So as I'm walking through all this stuff, it's clear that the Big Ten already knows who they want. And the only other fish left to fry is Notre Dame. So I think Oregon, Washington, all that stuff we heard about, maybe other teams going to the Big Ten,
yeah,
wipe it out.
Yeah.
And I think there's some speculation among Utah fans that the missing piece there, right, because you have an odd number with what you just described. Oregon, Washington, Notre Dame gets them to 19. And so I think there's some speculation that Utah fans have had about, like, oh, Utah makes sense because there's not a natural rival that it would have to be attached to or whatever. There's not, like, Utah could be make sense as that 20th team. And that could be true. I have no idea what the Big Ten's priorities are. I think if I'm the Big Ten commissioner and I have one spot to fill and all the teams but Oregon, Washington, and Notre Dame are off the board, I don't think Utah's my next pick. So yeah, if that is your hope right now, I suggest you prepare for bad news, because that's just – it's – we, again, in that group chat that Brian was talking about earlier, we talk a lot about things that are possible and things that are
– mythical?
I mean, things that, you know, we talk about impossible, and we talk about just – what am I trying to say? Just not worth counting on. It's so unrealistic. Like, it's impossible and so unrealistic that – sure, Utah winning a national championship is possible. At the current state of the program, it is so unrealistic to me that it's not something I'm counting on. And so kind of coming back to, like, panic levels even and where I'm at, like, I guess my thought with all of that is, what is it that we're panicking about? Because if the panic comes back to, you know, that original thought of, well, now only these two teams will be competing for that national championship. Utah just got a glass ceiling or whatever, just got a ceiling on its national championship abilities.
And that ceiling is not the roof, by the way.
No, that to me, you didn't have one. You didn't have realistic national championship like expectations in the current state of your program.
It's not a Busch Garden ceiling either.
And so this doesn't necessarily remove that. Yeah, it certainly has some long term effects and some long term considerations. But like, I guess to me, it's like, yeah, what is it that we're concerned about? Is it about being left out of the party?
Yes,
because we got left out like days ago.
Well, but I mean, if that's what it's about, it's just happening today instead of a few years from now. The constant problem of growth is that they will always need to achieve more. They need more fans. They need more revenue. That will always come down to, at the college level, at the program level, they need more revenue. They need more TV money. How do you do that? You trim the fat. You look at your, we've got folks who are below a certain amount of revenue contribution, kick them out. That's what just happened. It's either going to happen today or it's going to happen later. The fact of the matter is that Salt Lake, if the NCAA is turning into the NFL, Salt Lake is not an NFL city. It's just not a big enough city. You're just eventually not going to make that cut, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So like, I get it. It sucks. I'm not happy.
Yeah.
But it's kind of, I guess I'm saying this has been something in the tea leaves for quite a while, and it feels like it happened 2 years sooner than I was expecting.
Well, you wrote about this last year, so I think
it felt inevitable.
Yeah, I think that's a big thing to point out, is that you were on this a full year ahead of everybody else in terms of, like, this is what's going to happen. And
I wouldn't say I was on it as much as just saying, like, last year I just said, I wrote an article for UTZone.com that just said, this is not the time for the Pac-12 to be complacent and for the Pac-12 to sit tight. And for the most part, the Pac-12 did sit tight, and other conferences made small moves, small moves, not anything crazy. But here we are today, you know, obviously we'll never know what if anything would have changed, what teams would have been available for them to add, right? But here we are a year later with little to no movement, and the fate of the conference feels like it's dangling.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah.
I guess this is a good way to kind of wrap up what does seem most likely, though. And I know what I think, and I think Cam did a pretty good job of laying out what he thinks. What do you think is the most likely outcome for Utah here?
That's such a great question. You're the
dude
question.
Who talks to everybody.
That's, and like, to be like, nobody that I talk to is going to be somebody that has a pulse on what is truly happening, right? Like, these things are happening at such a level where it's the presidents and it's the athletic directors. They don't want this out unless my name is Dennis Dodd and my name is, you know, whoever else, John Wilner, right?
Yeah, like, Matt Brown, the Extra Points, had a good point about that today. That he very was just
excellent
like,
tweet.
Your sources on this are not going to be who you expect. They're right. going to be different people than he's mm-hmm. like. These are not going to be the people who are plugged into AD conversations or to head coach conversations. Like he's like, frankly, most of the athletic directors at most of these schools who are having these discussions probably aren't even involved. They're not in the room. They might not be involved in the conversations, period.
Yeah.
It's just not this decision is happening above their head.
Yep. Well, and you're going to like, this is one of those situations where you could have some real oddball sources, right? Like people who work at law firms that are somehow having this come across their desk.
Like this
right?
guy from Minnesota that apparently has a relationship with somebody in the Big Ten offices that is just leaking everything. Have you guys seen this guy?
No.
On Twitter? He's like called every single step months in advance.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like it's crazy. And he's some dude just on the Minnesota 247 site, just like tweeting all the stuff before it happened. It's crazy. So
yeah.
I'll send it to you. But Cam, that brings up.
That's me. That's my burner.
Yeah, that is your burner. Oh, shoot. Where was I going?
Big Gophers fan.
Oh, where was I going with
spin
that?
Spin your head.
So, no, okay, so back to your point about this being a decision of presidents and people of that nature. I think that is why I am currently
running for president of the University of Utah.
Declaring my candidacy? But no, I think,
he's
honestly,
running, folks.
This loose partnership...
Four more years.
This loose partnership, and I hate that we are calling it that. I hate that it is dubbed that. It should not be that. But I think, honestly, I think this is the goal of the Pac-12. And I think a large reason why is because presidents of Pac-10, Pac-12 schools don't want to be associated with programs from the Big 12, right? The religious institution factor, the academic factor, those are reasons why I think we're seeing George Kliavkov and the Pac-12 get this media rights opening. And
people don't want to hear that reason, but it's true. The thing that university presidents care about more than anything is their relationship with other university presidents.
Yeah.
And if they're damaging that, like, and again,
case in point, the entire Larry Scott era, right? Like, well, that's a perfect example of how all these university presidents loved him and it made a mess of the conference. Sorry, I shouldn't.
No, I just simply, my point was simply just athletics is pretty low on most of these presidents' lists of concerns, and they are usually. This is a distraction they didn't want to have.
Yes, absolutely.
And they understand the need of athletics, and it is to put their university to where they want it to be, right? Like, I think the University of Utah is a great example of that because got into the AAU, increased enrollment, admissions, you know, all this stuff goes up as you're suddenly a Pac-12 school. That's
the
reason for it.
All of those things are the things they care about.
Yes.
The AAU part, massive. I'm telling you right now, football fan or not, Taylor Randall would be better off losing Utah in a football conference than losing Utah in the AAU. Because one of those things means he loses his job, effective immediately.
Yes.
And the other one means that he's going to have to find other marketing resources to get his program's brand out there, which, by the way, there are thousands of universities that don't play college football. I don't know if there's thousands, but there are hundreds of colleges and universities that don't play college football that are getting along okay. You know, this is not a required thing for academic institutions to have.
No.
If this is causing them too much trouble, my point is simply it's something that they're not expecting to be on their radar at this point.
They
are caught off guard as well, and they don't – university presidents simply don't care about athletics like we do. And you need to have that frame of mind when you're thinking about this.
They care differently.
As passionate about it as you are.
Yes.
Athletics is a means to an end for them.
Yeah.
That's all it is. Athletics is their plug, right? And I need to point out that as Cam gets more excited talking about these things,
athletics is a department on campus to them.
Yeah.
It's the business school.
It's marketing.
It's the engineering school. It's the hospital. It's athletics is that to them. So like they don't view athletics in the realm that we do of – to fans, athletics is the university.
Yeah.
To the university president, athletics is the biggest headache of their job and the thing that they are graded on the least. They probably, for the most part, at these AAU institutions, they probably hate athletics because it's a very big, hard, difficult part of their job.
Yeah.
And again, it's not something – that as in academia, generally not the thing that you are promoting first and foremost for your institution.
I do think football plays a huge role, and I think
because I was gonna say
it's a growing.
It's not always a negative.
Yeah.
Like the president of Alabama, he loves football.
Yeah.
Again, there are exceptions,
sure,
right?
Sure. Yeah.
Alabama, Ohio State, these programs can't afford not to lean into football.
Yeah.
Like, my point is simply that if the athletics programs goes away, the university will continue to exist.
Right.
Dean Taylor Randall is aware of that, right?
Right.
He understands the priority of athletics at the University of Utah. All I was saying is that is not the same of the priority of athletics to Utah fans.
To Utah fans.
I think
that's great. And I again, getting back to it, I think that is why I look at a merger with the Pac-12 and the ACC, specifically the ACC, because I don't think they want to do that with the Big 12. I think that's a big motivating factor for George Kliavkov and the Pac-12 presidents.
A lot of really good schools in the ACC. And
North Carolina, Wake Forest,
Virginia,
all the Carolina
huge,
schools
yeah.
are very
Duke.
Prominent.
Duke?
Yeah.
Very much.
Academically prominent, right?
Yes.
Even, I know we talk a lot of trash about the Miami version of the U, but that's academically, that's a pretty reliable school.
Yeah.
You know, like that is a pretty, I'm not going to say prestigious, you know, because it is still in Miami, but
I don't
like,
know.
It is,
it's gorgeous. I've been there.
Well, it's a good school, you know, and I think like they have a few solid programs. You know, Kevin Clark, alumni.
But so like I said, I think that's most likely right now. There's a huge caveat lingering over all of this, and that's Notre Dame.
Yeah.
And I think Notre Dame, all of this hinges on what they decide to do. And Cam, we were talking before we started recording, and I was shocked. We were looking up Notre Dame's media rights, their contract. What do you, Brian? What do you think they pull from NBC?
I know it's at least $40 million.
Nope,
you're wrong. Well, I guess over how many years?
No, a year.
No,
nope.
No,
is it 80?
Nope. You're going the wrong way.
Oh,
way the wrong way.
Really?
Yeah.
I thought it was a lot higher. Is it $15-20 million a year?
$15 million a year from NBC. Yes.
Okay, but that's just for football.
That's just for football.
That's just for football home games.
Yes.
What do you think they get from the ACC?
So that's an interesting conversation because they're actually, like, for football, they're not part of that grant of rights discussion with the ACC.
Right.
So they're not locked into that through 2036. They're just
basketball. That blew my mind to learn that they were only getting $15 million a year from NBC.
Yeah. It makes sense when you think about it in terms of, like, what we were just saying, that's only football home games. Yeah. So that's like
six,
that's
games,
like $2.5 million
right.
dollars per home game. That's, I don't know how that stacks up with other things or other events or like, you know, how that breaks down for other coverage. But I think that helps kind of normalize those amounts. $2.5 million per home game for Notre Dame. Like, I think that if they want to join the Big Ten, it seems the offer is clearly there for them. I think it seems like a no-brainer mm-hmm. if they're really making that much. I mean, because at the end of the day, right? If they're getting
how much do
million,
they get from the ACC? Sorry,
10 to 11 million.
So like let's call it 10. So let's say if they're getting 20 from NBC, which we think is high, and they're getting 10 from the ACC. If they're getting $30 million a year, they're leaving $70 million on the table by not being in the Big Ten.
Right.
So we either don't know something about money that Notre Dame is getting and why they can't be – why it doesn't make sense for them to be in the Big Ten, or they have something else up their sleeve that they think could be more profitable. Otherwise, they're signing already.
I don't think it has anything to do with profitability. Because I think you're right. They don't need the TV money. This is Notre freaking Dame.
Right.
Right.
Well, I mean, they'll take the TV money, though.
I don't think, yeah.
Yeah,
if
sure.
If you're offering me $70 million of gravy per year, I'll take it.
But the reason that they want what they want in terms of the NBC deal and being separated from the grant of rights agreement with the ACC is they want that independence.
Yeah.
They love the idea that they are, in essence, a conference unto themselves.
Yeah.
And they can schedule their own way. They can be national. They can be this.
That's dumb. That's not worth $70 million a year.
I'm serious.
It's dumb.
I get what you're saying, but at the same time, like it's like if you're taking a job where you're making $85,000 a year versus $99,000, but the $85,000 a year, you only work 30 hours a week, and you get unlimited vacation time, and you can just disappear for a day, don't you kind of like that job more? Like, it's not that big of
a
difference.
What if it's $85,000 compared to $100 million?
Yeah,
because but that's not like the range you gave would be as if Notre Dame was getting $80 million from NBC.
But
they're getting 15.
Yeah,
but NBC's reaching to the couch and tossing them change.
Yeah,
and well, the Big Ten's just like, we have fat stacks for you over so, here.
Yeah, but that's the thing. Like, they don't need the money. Like,
bull.
How much money do you think that athletic department pulls in donor stuff alone, Cam?
They're still going to get that money.
That's what I'm saying. Like, they don't need the TV money. So, like, what are you going to do? Like,
Brian, this
the
is
Big
an
Ten
insane
drops
take.
No.
That they couldn't use the extra $70 million because they're Notre Dame is
well,
insane.
It's not
going to
be extra,
USC
right?
is going to fly across the country six times a
but
year.
But it's not extra. It's not extra $70 million because you're not going to have the NBC deal. Like, Fox is not going to be like, yeah, come beat in the Big Ten, but you can keep your NBC deal. So you're getting $70 million now instead of the
no, you're
30,
getting $100 million
yeah, getting
now instead
yeah.
of the $30
million. Oh, I see what you're saying. I mean, that was the initial number. I'm not convinced that that's the number, right?
I don't know. That was from Sports Business Journal.
But this is,
from
again,
the SBJ.
Again, this is coming back to what do we know?
You're right, right.
If
right.
we're assuming that the number is $100 million, obviously, yeah. Yes, this is a good argument in favor that the number is probably not $100 million.
Sure.
But at the same time, my point is simply that the number is big. It's big as shit.
But here's
and it's
the thing.
A lot bigger than Notre Dame's getting today.
Yeah.
And so if they're not moving on this, they have a good reason.
Yeah. Right.
And I don't think independence is a good enough reason.
And I think something else to keep in mind, their media rights still expires in 2025.
Yeah.
2 years away. And that's right when Oklahoma and Texas make that move to the SEC. So do you bite the bullet for 2 years, allow that contract to expire, open it up, and we are now a Notre Dame Blockcast talking Notre Dame.
What? Yeah.
But I think that's something. Notre Dame has loved their independence, and I'm with you, Cam. You do not turn down the opportunity at $100 million.
But
you do not turn that down. And I know, like, tradition – and,
USC
and rivalries.
USC just put a dagger in the heart of 100-year partnerships.
Yes.
That is how much money we're talking about. These universities.
Yeah, because USC is going broke.
They might have hired.
UCLA is going broke.
They might
have
hired.
Well, so is USC, though. Because USC had to pay out $400 million last year in a lawsuit settlement.
Oh,
right?
Damn. Oh, yeah. Oh,
you want to talk about schools who don't need the money and suddenly USC's now broke? Now it's
USC
like, oh,
does...
Notre Dame. Notre Dame. Dude, Notre Dame USC is just ripping up checks. Crazy. Notre Dame doesn't bother cashing checks. But you, poor USC, won't we please think
no,
of
no,
USC?
No. USC needs the money. They do. That's the problem. They put all... No, no, no. Listen to me.
I'm
not
listening.
Crazy.
I'm listening.
I'm not
listening.
Crazy.
You're
here.
Not crazy. You're
because
not crazy.
Here's the thing. You're USC not. Has lost all their booster stuff and stuff and all that donation power into NIL. So they do not get the same amount of revenue. Plus, they just knocked off, what was it, a $60 million, $90 million renovation project?
Yeah, I think so,
for the
yeah.
Coliseum.
Yeah, yeah.
Plus, there's a ton of... I'm not crazy on this. I swear, this is what's happening. And so they are losing money in the athletic department. That's why they had to make this move. And so that... because, listen, if you go back and read all the articles, the biggest driver for this was Carol Alt, the university president. They are not in dire financial straits, but if you have to write a check for $400 million and a lot of that comes from your athletic department budget after you just dropped all this cash and donors are like, you guys just got hit with a massive sexual abuse lawsuit, we're out. You have financial problems.
Yeah.
And so they, like, I know you're clowning on me and that's fine. I don't care because it was funny as hell, but they do have some issues. UCLA, 10 times worse, 10 times worse.
This is enough to solve both of those universities' issues, and you're like, Notre Dame doesn't need it.
And that's why. That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. Because you know what it is? It's like the Big Ten brought in this giant bag of cash, and Notre Dame's just like, oh, and they opened up their vault, and it's Scrooge McFreaking.
Do
Duck
you know what rich people love? Rich people love more money.
Is the Big Ten richer than the Catholic Church?
They're about to be. Oh, this is so funny. This is so funny.
Do you think the Catholic Church is funding Notre Dame enough?
When was the last time you saw a financial statement on how much money Notre Dame is worth?
This is crazy.
Football. Notre Dame football.
No. I don't need to, because from I have good sources that tell me they don't need $70 million.
I'm not saying they don't need it, but like Steve pointed out.
So
like,
it's a good point. That's
stop.
The church money is
stop.
Good.
Steve pointed out just now. So here's the problem, right? We're in this war right now, okay? Oh, and Notre Dame's rights are up in 2024.
25.
Same time.
25.
Okay. So they have a window now where they can start negotiating with NBC.
Sure.
How much live programming does NBC really have right now if they lose Notre Dame?
Yeah, we were talking about this a little bit, though, too, Steve and I. And they don't have a lot. And that's what we were kind of tossing around the idea of what would it look like if Notre Dame, you know, what is that other scenario? They've yeah. got, if they have another plan, right? If they don't need the Big Ten money because they have another plan, what does that plan look like? And does that plan involve NBC, right? It could, a cool scenario could be something like Notre Dame coming together with some of the powers of the other remaining conferences, your Dukes, your North Carolinas, your Miamis, your Florida States, your Clemsons, and, you know, all of the six Pac-12 schools that have been discussed, and, you know, bring some of the Big 12 schools in, create kind of a third super conference of your own, and then have NBC back that. But I just don't think NBC is that committed to sports other than, you know, they've got, they pick their battles, right? They've got Sunday Night Football, they've got Notre Dame football, and they've got like the Olympics. And outside of that, I guess, is NBC trying to get into that game? Because they do have some interesting resources with like Peacock, where right. they could pretty easily stream quite a few games without needing to add a bunch of channels or add a whole network for a conference or something, right? You could effectively say, let's scale this conference's viewership using an already existing streaming model, something that the Pac-12 was dreaming of doing and just could never get over the edge. This would be, you know, teaming up potentially with a group that already has that. And so yeah. I'm curious to see if, again, like, there's so much that we don't know and so much, obviously, that we're going to learn. But, like, what we think is going to happen today might not even be close.
Right.
We might be barking up way wrong trees.
And that's really my point with the whole Notre Dame thing. Is it's not so much the fact that they want to turn down an extra $70 million, right?
I'm pretty sure they're confident that if they want to go make that up somewhere, they can. Okay?
Sure. Yeah.
What they want is they want the flexibility to do whatever the hell they want without being told what to do by Kevin Warren and whatever Fox executive that they have zero relationship with. Like, to Notre Dame, protecting the Notre Dame brand is priority number one, right?
Well, and so with the move to the Big Ten, that means all sports for the Big Ten. And
yeah,
the grant of rights for all sports with for all other sports other than football is still there. They're tied to the SEC. So that's still – that would be a lump sum of money that would – have to be factored in.
And you figure these things
in.
Out.
Right? And yeah, and you figure
write
out
a check for it.
Sure, right. Sure, sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
They've got the Catholic Church backing them. So
Ireland is a big market for Notre Dame.
They'll
you
just
talk about the world was, being your campus.
You guys were so funny.
They'll just rip
incredible
up one of those checks that the ACC's writing them. Yeah. They'll just be like, ah, we'll just.
There you go.
I'm excited to listen to this tomorrow.
It was in the shred pile anyway.
I was seeing red because I had something good to say, but Cam, when he was talking about poor USC. Is gonna
you know
make
who else?
Laugh.
You know who else? Poor Jazz fans, right? Am I right? Poor yeah, Jazz
pour
fans.
Pour one out for Jazz fans.
Yeah, pour I'm one out for Jazz fans.
I'm going to eat it.
You know who needs $100 million? Jazz fans. Come on, Ryan
for
Smith.
For
million
for a couple more rebrands.
Ideas.
Yeah, jeez. Good grief. Anyways, Brian, Cam, this has been a lot of fun.
Y'all complained. You got us now. We're back.
About the dumbest stuff.
Scrooge McDuck so vault.
We went on. This is a Utah podcast, from what I understand.
And yeah,
we went on a pretty good Notre Dame, USC tangent.
Holy smokes! So, anyways, let's recap. So, Jazz uniforms, awful. Panic level. Cam, you're pretty chill. You're calm. You're feeling good.
Unless you tell him Notre Dame doesn't. $70 million.
Apparently.
We figured out Cam's trigger.
Brian's like, no, like you set a case of money and a gun in front of Notre Dame, and Brian's like, they held their hand out. They're like, I learned about myself. My hand does
hey,
not shake.
Hey, listen, like we all know where Notre Dame is based on.
Oh man,
take the what is it? Leave the gun, take the cannoli, or take the gun, leave the cannoli. Right?
Isn't that New York?
It's Godfather, but I just Italians are Catholic.
All of them?
Oh my goodness!
We gotta wrap this up before we say something we're gonna regret.
In my mafia world, yeah, that's how it is.
So, anyways, go Utes, and we'll wrap this one up.
Breaking news coming in from Bet365, where every nail-biting overtime win, breakaway, pick six, three-point shot, underdog win, buzzer beater, shootout, walk-off, and absolutely every play in between is amazing. From football to basketball and hockey to baseball, whatever the moment, it's never ordinary at Bet365. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. 21 plus only. Must be physically located in Virginia.
We all belong outside. We're drawn to nature. Whether it's the recorded sounds of the ocean we doze off to, or the succulents that adorn our homes, nature makes all of our lives, well, better. Despite all this, we often go about our busy lives removed from it. But the outdoors is closer than we realize. With All Trails, you can discover trails nearby and explore confidently. With offline maps and on-trail navigation, download the free app today and make the most of your summer with All Trails.
Breaking news coming in from Bet365, where every nail-biting overtime win, breakaway, pick six, three-point shot, underdog win, buzzer beater, shootout, walk-off, and absolutely every play in between is amazing. From football to basketball and hockey to baseball, whatever the moment, it's never ordinary at Bet365. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. 21 plus only. Must be physically located in Virginia.